It's really good. It's a nice to use for worship.
It is.
So So we're going to have a little bit of fun with that. If there's no other word, let's stand together, greet each other in the name of the Lord. sickness has hit us, and we want to pray for everyone this year. Will we prove allergies, the flu, the stomach bug? I think we all know if we've had it, or we know people have had it. We want to keep them in the prayers, especially our pastor and his family. We pray it's not the flu, but if it is, we want to pray that God comes upon him and lessens the severity of that. And anything else you'd like to bring to the body this morning, let's make that known right now, please. Be back.
Hey. Brother George Turk is going through quite a lot of stuff right now, and he's asked for a lot of prayer.
Brother George Turk, very active in our Maine's community pastors. Please be in prayer for him. Yes, ma'am.
Emily's on a mission trip, and my mother is not doing well at all.
Thank you, Mike. Appreciate that. Emily's on a fishing trip, and her mom is not doing well at all. We'll keep those absolutely in our prayer. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
My dad.
Your dad. Let's remember those that we have unspoken requests for. That the Lord knows, you know in your heart, who will keep it close to us. Yes, sir.
Keep praying for my mother, still got health issues. And also my son has some kids on a mission trip with the high school, coming with the college team. Yeah. The mentalist child.
Amen. That's two mission trips. Okay. Amen. Anyone else? And those who could not be with us this morning.
All right.
If there's nothing else, let's bow before the Lord this morning. I'm losing my voice, so Andy, would you take us to the throne of grace, please?
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunities that you've laid before us to pray for those who are in need. All kinds of needs, Father God, sickness needs, financial needs, just emotional well-being. People going through depression in this time of year, seasonal changes affecting folks. Father God, many things in our world that's broken. Lord, we ask you to set a fire in this broken world through us. We've made a commitment, Father God, to be your hands and your feet, and we ask that you show us the paths in which to walk, introduce us to the people that need counsel, friendship, and fellowship, and let us be a light into this broken world. We thank you, Father God, for this time that we're in, this season of Lent, where we remember all of the things that you've done leading up to and including your passion and death, where you have redeemed creation, and it is still being redeemed this day. We ask, Father God, that you be with us during our service. We ask that you be with our pastor, both of them. Our pastor who is giving our message, and our pastor this morning who is seeking medical help. And we thank you, Father God, from the bottom of our hearts, because we know that when we ask, you send ministering spirits to minister to the heirs of salvation, which are us. So we stand in faithfulness this morning, Father God, of all of your promises, because your word is true. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Would our ushers come forward, please?
Oh, the mighty hand and an outstretched arm.
Thank you. The Lord is with us.
Amen.
Let's pray. Thank you, dear God, because we are here because of you, only for you. And today, we are open to the work of the Holy Spirit. Please open our ears, because we are ready to hear your voice. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Well, this morning, I was very surprised. A few minutes before the service started, and I have my sermon ready. Always I'm ready. The only thing is that it's in Spanish. So when I know that I will be preaching, I have the time to put it in English. So please pray, because my challenge today is reading in Spanish and speaking English. So, also, I was very surprised because most of the time I have PowerPoints. It's here. But today, the screens are not working. My presentation is on my phone, but it's very small. So, for the last few weeks, we have studied the book of the Gospel of Mark. Honestly, I didn't learn too much about this Gospel. And I noticed that since the first chapter to the chapter 7, there is a big point, and this point is the hardness of the heart. Jesus was speaking with a religious man. And I remember that, for example, last week, Brother Mike was preaching about a very special point and also very difficult, which is the sin of the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. It's a very, very hard situation. But again, the point is the hardness of the heart. And today, our scripture is talking about very interesting things. And I was reading the whole chapter, and the chapter is divided in two sections. The first section is talking about, again, the hardness of the heart. But the other section, I was very impressed because it talks about a Greek woman. And this woman had a girl. The girl was sick. And again, the Bible says that it was possessed for an unclean spirit. Several difficult situations to understand for us. However, Jesus was very compassionate with this woman, and her daughter was healed. Jesus is the Lord above all the Lords. And today, the second part of the chapter 7 talks about the death a mute man. And this conveys to me to think in three questions. The first one is, where was Jesus in this situation? Where was Jesus? The second question is, what was the attitude of the people? And the third is, what teaching can we learn from the healed man, The first question is very important, that is focused in a place which is called Decapolis. And this city reminds me that Mark 5, from the verses 18 20 talk about this city. Someone could help me to read these verses in English, please. Mark 5, verses 18 to 20. It's only to be or understand a little bit more.
Mark 5, 18 to 20. Jesus was getting into the boat. A man who had been demon-possessed begged to go with him. Jesus did not let him, but said, "Go home to your family and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has mercy on you." So the man went away and began to tell the disciples, or the Decapolis, how much Jesus had done for him, and all the people were amazed.
When we see chapter 7, it's the second time that Jesus was in the Decapolis. The Decapolis, it was a region, and this region has 10 cities, which this word Decapolis comes from 10. Well, in Spanish is very simple, because I think Decapolis, 10, or 10. But the Decapolis means 10 cities. So Jesus, for the second time in chapter 7, was in the Decapolis. The first time that he was there is because there was a man. Again, the Bible in this chapter talks about a man who was possessed for many unclean spirits. The point here is that Jesus, again, healed or liberated this man from 2,000 unclean spirits. Can you imagine this amount? It's hard to imagine 2,000 unclean spirits only in one man. But we can see the power of the Lord, the power of Jesus Christ, the power that Jesus is God. So the point here is that this man, after received the liberation from the Lord, he was very, very thankful to Jesus. And he wanted to follow Jesus. And he asked Jesus, "I want to go with you." But Jesus said, no. "I want you to remain here in this city and proclaim to all this region, in the region of the Decapolis, the things that the Lord has made with you." And the man obeyed Jesus Christ, and he stayed in that region, saying to the people, "The miraculous, marvelous, the marvelous that Jesus done with him." But the question is, we want to contextualize this situation to our situation. Please think about the people around us in this community, here in Belgaco or Murfreesboro, should be. Can we think in these people around us? Can we think about the attitude of the people towards God? Can we think probably only in one person? How is the attitude of this person toward God in our community? I'm talking about people who, for some reason, don't want to approach to Jesus Christ. I'm talking about the people that sometimes they don't come to church. Sometimes, probably they don't want to read the Bible. I'm talking about these kind of people. Can we imagine people around us. I have experienced a few times in this community, in the area, not exactly here in Belgaco, or not exactly with the English congregation, but with the Spanish community. I have experienced a few times that some women have called me because sometimes or they heard that God loves them and He is all powerful. And some ladies have called me and said, I have a problem. I have someone in my family who is sick. Could you please come and pray for she or for he? And I said, of course. I was there. And I remember a lady. And probably I shared with this before, probably. But I remember a woman that the doctor said, your little girl cannot walk. And the first thing that I said is, okay, let's see what the Bible said. And I presented to them the plan of salvation. After that, I said, I am not special. I just will pray to God. God is special. God is powerful. And I pray for this little girl. And after a month, the little started to walk. Amen. All the glory is only to God. But the question is, what if this family already saw the power of God? Why they continue with hardness of heart? It's a question. Why people in our community are seeing the marvels of God and they continue with a hard heart towards God? It's the question. But let's continue with chapter 7 in Mark. Jesus is in the Decapolis for the second time, and this time was different. Do you remember what the chapter 5 talks about? The people said an important thing in that scripture, said that the first time they said to Jesus, please go away from here. We don't want you here with us. We want to continue in our we want to continue with the lifestyle. Go away from here. But amen, do you remember? Stay there and declare the marvelous that Jesus is going to do with him or did with him. This second time, in chapter 7, Jesus is in the Decapolis. But the reaction of the people was different. The reaction was that they wanted to be with Jesus. Because we don't know how many times, how much time have passed between the first and the second visit. During this time, there was a man proclaiming the marvelous thing that Jesus did with him. So this second time, in chapter 7, the reaction of the people was different. They knew about the healer, the marvelous healer. I think many of us have been in situations that we have relative sins, or nosotros mismos, ourselves, our sins, and we need to look at a good doctor. Unfortunately, here in this congregation, we had a very good doctor, Ms. Barbara. But I remember, I'm not sure if you have seen the movie The Gifted Hands. Do you have seen this movie, The Gifted Hand? No? Oh, Miss Mijan. It's a very good movie. I don't want to talk about politics, because the principal character in this movie is Ben Carson, but I don't want to talk about politics. I want to talk about him, about how important was his work as a physician. There was a family, I don't remember the family is from New Zealand or from England, I don't remember that. The point is that they have a twins, and they want, they need a surgery because their hands were united. So the only physician that can do this was Ben Carson. And they traveled all the way to see this physician, and the surgery was successful. In this world, we have excellent physicians, but as a Christian, we know that the best is Jesus Christ. Yeah. It's our Lord. In this time, in the Decapolis, Jesus was challenged for people, and they brought to him, or before him, a dead and mute man. I have experienced my grandpa from my father's side was a dead. It was a difficult situation, because I remember that I was probably 8 or 10 years. And sometimes when my mom said, please call grandpa, because it's time to lunch, I wanted to go with him next time. You know why? Because I need to scream him, Dad, the lunch is ready. And I didn't like it. I can imagine this man, how many times this man was lonely. How many times was lonely? My grandpa, I remember his life was very lonely. Because we had the possibilities to buy special devices for their eyes. They were so expensive. We tried to speak with him, we tried to be nice with him, but sometimes it was so hard. That, from this context, I can imagine this man who was in front of Jesus Christ. Jesus was very compassionate with him. Because Jesus has, until this day, to see the world, and people can be healed. But Jesus was forward, and Jesus not only declared the word, but Jesus touched the man. And it's very important, this kind of thing, the physical. It's very important, the physical touch. And Jesus did this with the deaf and mute man. And Bible says that their ears were opened, and his mouth, his tongue was, the Bible said, his tongue was released. I'm blessed to have a hero like that. God showed me that we need to pray for people around us because their ears are close to the voice of the Holy Spirit. And we need to pray for us also because our tongues need to be released to declare the marvelous things that Jesus has been made with us. How many people are here? Probably 50, something like that. Can you imagine if every one of us pray this week only for one person that their ears can be open? Can we imagine if each one of us speak this week only for one person and declare the marvelous that God has made with us and the love that God has with them? Suddenly, this place could be crowded, could be full. Can you imagine that? I think this is the teaching for us today. We need to pray that the ears of the people can be open. And we need to pray for boldness to us to declare the marvels that God has made with us. God bless you. be with us now and forever.
Amen.